Candymonium is Hersheypark's tallest, fastest, and longest roller coaster. It headlines a new expansion to the front entrance of Hersheypark called ChocolateTown. This will now be the first roller coaster you'll come to when you enter the park, with its signature element being a helix around a Hershey Kisses fountain, making for a very eye-catching and signature entrance to the park. The whole thing looks great, and this is going to be my full in-depth review of the attraction. As of when this video is being made, I've ridden it probably 7 or 8 times. I got the opportunity to experience multiple seats during different times of day, so I feel like I got a really good feel for the ride. And even though to some who may view this as just another B&M hyper, I feel like there's quite a bit to talk about here. In my opinion, B&M has gotten better at perfecting their design of the hyper coaster. I find that I much prefer their newer hypers versus some of their olders, with a few exceptions. But since I rode it in 2018, Shambhala has been my favorite hyper coaster, and since I rode it in 2017, Mako is my favorite in the US. And at the end of this video, I'm going to let you know how I think Candymonium stacks up to those two. But I'll tell you right off the bat, I really enjoyed this attraction. I went as far as tweeting right after I got off my first ride that I preferred this over Orion, the other new B&M to debut in 2020. Orion may be taller, faster, and longer, but at the end of the day, stats don't matter if your layout isn't as strong. I think Candymonium, in general, is a more well-rounded roller coaster. But that's just my opinion. Let's walk through this experience. Now, the first thing I got to say is that Candymonium has its own dedicated plaza. You walk up to this massive building that is the station. It is absolutely enormous, and Hersheypark is calling it their first fully themed station. Now, when they say themed, this is an American amusement park's definition of theming. And by that, I mean they have some pretty colors on the ceiling, some logos of some of their candies, and a couple lights. It's better than nothing, but don't go in expecting a whole lot. I do think the ceiling looks really cool right as you're dispatching out of the station. But in my opinion, the best part about this building is I love the facade on the outside. I think the design of the station matches perfectly with the rest of Chocolatetown, and so it has a really nice aesthetic to it. So when you enter the station, you're going to choose between one of 7 different rows, meaning this is one of the shorter trains on a B&M hypercoaster, which I do think is interesting. I don't mind it, but it does seem like they keep on shortening their trains as opposed to lengthening them. I'm not an engineer, but my guess would be they do that because they're going to be making tighter turns as opposed to more drawn out turns when you could have a longer train. But I don't work for B&M, so I don't know that for a fact. I chose a backseat ride for my first time, but at the end of the day, I actually preferred this ride in the front. Like every other roller coaster, the drop is going to be a lot better in the back, but I felt like the airtime was strongest in the front, with the exception of the outer bank, which I preferred in the back. Everything else though, the speed, the forces, the airtime, I think I liked better in the front. But definitely try it out in both rows. This is a ride you want to do over and over again anyways. So we got 4 across seating. When you sit down, you're going to fasten a seat belt and pull down your B&M clamshell restraint. The seat belts are the exact same as Orion's, where they're retractable, but they lock. So they'll be tight at one point, but if you're getting a lot of airtime, they'll come looser. It's kind of hard to explain. You kind of have to experience it in order to really understand what I'm getting at here. It's sort of like a car seat belt in a way of how it'll lock at some point. At the end of the day, I would prefer if they just weren't there at all. And to my understanding, it is a park request in order to put those on the train, meaning Hersheypark wanted them there. B&M did not require it, which is why you don't see them on a lot of other B&Ms. So that is a downside in my opinion, but I don't think it drastically takes away from the ride experience. It just might mean during some moments you might not get as much airtime as you would otherwise. So you depart the station, start up the lift till you climb 210 feet in the air. That is 10 feet higher than Skyrush. You plummet down at a 77 degree angle, some great floater air there in the back, and at the bottom of that hill you hit your max speed of 76 miles an hour, which is 1 mile an hour faster than Skyrush. And this starts off with a pretty traditional B&M layout. After your first drop, you have a giant floater hill and then a turnaround. Some B&M hypers will go out 2 hills and then turn around. This one only goes out 1, which makes sense when you actually look at the amount of space that they had to work with here. This ride goes out onto an area that used to be a golf course before Hershey acquired it. So pretty much the turnaround bumps up against the road. So that's why you'll find that the ride almost does more during the second half of the ride than during the first, and I'm gonna get to that later. And frankly, there's not a whole lot to say about that first hill turnaround and even the hill right after it. They're pretty typical moments that you'd find on other roller coasters. They're done very well. They're engineered perfectly so they feel natural. It's very smooth. This entire ride is about as smooth as you can get. Something you might want to be aware of, though, there are two different points during the ride where you will encounter trim brakes on the hills. The first one is on that first hill right after the turnaround. That one does not hit that hard. So frankly, that one doesn't bother me. The second one though, well, we'll get to that. So after that first hill coming back, we have a speed hill that is almost identical to the one that you would experience on Shambhala, Mako, Orion. It's low to the ground, really nice floater, and that leads into an upwards helix. And this is definitely a gray out moment. You're experiencing some high G's here. Depending on how fast it's running, this might be the second moment during the ride when you could gray out. Sometimes I would gray out at the bottom of the first drop going into that first airtime hill. I didn't really do that in the morning, but later in the day when it was running faster, yeah, I was graying out there, meaning this was my second point during the ride when I was graying out. Your vision clears up once you hit the top of that moment and you start to bank outwards, which is by far the most unique thing about this ride. We haven't really seen this on another B&M Hyper, and it's a fun little moment. It's B&M saying, all right, let's try and be edgy here, let's do something different, mix things up a bit. And it's not bad. Is it whippy or out of control feeling? Definitely not. But I don't think it's necessarily meant to be. I think if you're in the front, it's a little underwhelming just because you don't really get that pop when you twist into it. But when you're in the back, you get a bit more pull through it. And so as I mentioned in the beginning, I think that is definitely the best way to experience that moment. And from here, we head into the plaza. We got another large floater hill, and this is when we encountered the second set of trim brakes, and this is the one that really hits. You might not notice that as much in the front, but if you're in the back, you're gonna feel maybe 1, 2, or 3 mile an hour difference as soon as you hit that. But the good news is, it doesn't really prevent you from getting airtime on that hill. You're still gonna come up out of your seat. You get low to the ground and bank sharply to the left. And this is my favorite moment on Candymonium. Passing around the Kisses Fountain is such a cool feeling. It's a great sensation. Almost every time I rode, instead of staring straight ahead, I'd keep my eyes locked on that fountain and follow it all the way around. And I think that is so cool. I can see it already. Some families where some want to ride Candymonium and others don't are gonna stand right next to the fountain and watch their family members pass around it when on the roller coaster. It's a great photo op and it's a great moment on the ride. And after that, you do a slight little bank and a little bunny hop into the brake run. And there's two sets of brakes here. You slow down when you hit the first one and then you bank slightly to the right, and then that's when you hit your main brakes. I thought it was kind of funny. I pointed out that it is the exact same brake run setup as Sky Rush. You slow down at the first set, bank to the right, and then that's when you hit your final brakes. I thought that was super weird. For Candymonium, it's just so that you can get from one side of the pathway to the other, but on Sky Rush, it's because you gotta go around Comet. Just something I noticed. So, how does this compare to other B&M Hypers? For me, it is towards the top. I think it has a really fun layout, some great airtime, it looks good, and it's super rewritable. I went out and said that I think Mako has the stronger first half, but Candymonium has the stronger second half. If you kind of split up the ride by based off of where the speed hill is, after the speed hill on Mako, there's not a whole lot there. I mean, the pass over the water is kind of cool, but it's not amazing or anything. I feel like Candymonium shines after the speed hill. So if you almost put the first half of Mako with the second half of Candymonium, I think that's like the ultimate B&M Hypercoaster right there. So for that reason, I think I still like Mako more. And of course, Shambhala is still top dog for me. But I'd say this is probably my third or fourth favorite B&M Hypercoaster. I think I like it more than Behemoth and Goliath, but I need to give it a little bit more thought. But overall, I really do like the attraction. I think B&M and Hershey Park knocked it out of the park with this ride. So for its final score, I'm going to give it a 9.5 out of 10. Why did I take off half a point? I just really don't like that trim brake on that one hill, man. But hey, that's just me. But I want to hear from you guys. What do you think of Candymonium at Hershey Park in Hershey, Pennsylvania? If you've gotten the chance to experience it, be sure to post down below what you think of the ride. And if you're trying to decide whether to head to Hershey Park to try out this ride, I hope this helped you. If you're new to the channel, I'd love if you could subscribe. I do reviews of roller coasters all across the world. So thank you for joining me in this video, and I'll see you next time.